metta, to practice metta, and to develop metta, you need a context that is supporting that, without it being too soft and too sweet and too everything is possible. We are happy with everything. So metta is not about sentiments. Metta is about, you know, it's a real clear open heart practice. And you work for it, you know, it's not just there. It is there, but you know, we have to work for it, enable it for it to shine. One of the principles, and our architect defined that very well, is that it should be comfortable without pampering. So you should not feel too much at home. It has to challenge you in a way, you know, without being ascetic. So what we have tried to do, not only in the design, but also in the way we decorated it, is to make people feel comfortable and challenge them at the same time.
It's unfussy and it's functional. There's nothing to distract, or not much to distract. On the whole, front and back are kind of quite close together, and they're open both ends, which hopefully will invite people to kind of open up in themselves too, to kind of flow out of yourself, out into the nature around. But that takes, you know, that takes a bit of courage.
The relationship with the landscape. So we have these high windows, like the glass, so the difference between the inside and outside is very subtle in a way. You're there in the landscape, walking in the building, whether it's winter or summer or spring or snow or whatever.
For 5 years we had about 20 retreats a year, renting different accommodations. Our original idea was the spreading of the Dharma in the Low Countries, and I think that still holds. We see it as two pillars. One pillar of Metta-vihara, which would say deepening the practice, so particularly for those people who Buddhism and or meditation already has a place in their life, so you want to help them to deepen their practice. But at the same time, you want to broaden, you want to widen, because you want to attract more people. Not so much because we want to be bigger, but because you want more people to benefit from the practice of meditation and from what the Buddha had to say, you know, what really contributes to real happiness. In many ways, all we need is metta. And you want the world to know that. You want the world to know that all we need is some friendliness, some kindness, some empathy, occasionally putting yourself in somebody's shoes, you know, not only walking in your own worn out familiar shoes. Can get boring, can't it? Your own shoes. So in a way that's metta, you know, trying to understand, to empathize, to sympathize. Through deepening our experience of metta, we can broaden. The widening, the reaching out, has to come from our own practice. It can't be something superficial.
The real fundament of a spiritual life is metta. You see, many Buddhists are looking for enlightenment or for awakening or for emptiness. But the basic problem of life is what the Buddha stated in the Kalama Sutta, that we are all driven by greed, by hatred, and by illusion. That's the real problem of life, where all suffering comes from. There is only one way to get out of it, and that way is opening up, is stopping of being a grabbing person, a person who pushes away everything he doesn't like, and the person just telling himself fairy stories. And when you do that, well, then automatically you come in a completely different state of mind, and that state of mind is metta. And, the fulfillment of it is called awakening, and that fulfillment is just metta, which has become completely, completely limitless.
We hold about 4 vision days a year. Those days are really meant to bring all the people together who are in one way or another involved in the practical running of the project. So that counts to about 30 volunteers from both countries, Holland and Belgium. From the trustees of Metta Vihara and the vision group, we keep sharing our ideal and our vision for the place and for Bente's vision and how we want to translate that here.
Metta Vihara is more than just a place where you mow the grass and where you clean and where you cook food. It's more than that. And there's more to learn in a way. And Metta as a driving force in doing that together.
In a way, the vision is enormous. And at the same time, it's so small in how to put it into practice. The practice is in the smallness of things. You know, nobody would argue with me about the importance of kindness in the world. But when it actually comes to being kind, you know, that is what it's all about. That is what will change the world.
I don't think I exaggerate that everybody who has been here goes away as slightly more kind and friendly. You know? This building is not just a building, it's a living organism. You know, breathing in and out and spreading metta and kindness and, you know, absorbing it.
Metta!
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 Again!
Metta!
It is a statement of metta. I think that's the most simple way to put it. It's a statement of metta. Yeah. Yeah.
It's strange in Russia that after communism, a lot of people have become publicly Christians again. My sense of the country as a whole is that Christian values are much more deeply embedded in a Russian psyche than, say, democratic values. I live in Moscow and I work teaching the Dharma, teaching meditation and Buddhism there. And I've been there 4 years, and a small sangha is beginning to emerge now after a couple of years of classes. We don't have a centre. We rent rooms in a general spiritual centre for 3 classes a week, and as always with new classes, it's fairly small to begin with. Sometimes 1 or 2 or 3 people turn up, sometimes 6, 7 or 8. I think 9 has been our limit so far. It's been the biggest class. It's always quite a strange experience. You arrive in a new city. You don't really know anybody. On the first day, I looked at the map of Moscow and I decided, well, what's the most interesting part? And I took a metro to somewhere in the centre and I walked up and down for a few hours and had a look around. On the second day I chose another place and then I walked around and walked up and down. I quite quickly got a sense that the second place, which is called Chisti Prudi, was somewhere I felt at home in. It was quite central, quite cosmopolitan, but also more relaxed. When I was living in Paris beforehand, I developed a habit of reading a book in a bar at the end of the day. And I carried on when I arrived in Moscow. And one of those evenings, a young woman, she noticed I was reading a book on Buddhism. And she asked me about it and found out that I was a member of the Triratna Buddhist Order and said that if I wanted to teach, she had worked at a place that I could hold classes at. She gave me the address of somebody to talk to, which actually helps a lot. In Russia, things operate a lot on the basis of personal connections. So if you know somebody in advance, it's a lot easier than just turning up. I started living in a small hostel where other tourists, sometimes Russian people, would come and stay, usually for a few days. The owner was a woman called Galina, and she had a flat with three bedrooms. And she lived in one room with her husband, and there was a third room with five beds. And I lived in the third room. I had a bed there. There was a couple of wardrobes that I used. I put my books on top of the wardrobe. It became a bit of an unofficial bookshelf because all the bookshelves were used. And it fits with Dhanagarika lifestyle, being homeless and not having my own place, which means it's a lot less expensive. It means my resources, my time, can be much more dedicated to Dharma work and or having time to reflect, do nothing, read, meditate. I was originally born in Russia. It was always, in a way, on the cards that I'd go back, although it wasn't always obvious to me. It was almost like I had a Russian internal conditioning and I needed to operate within a context, an objective Russian set of conditionings to understand myself more deeply. The Russian language is very different to English. The Russian way of thinking is very different to English. It feels that I'm getting to know myself more deeply, and I have noticed that it has meant that I can more fully communicate myself both in Russia and with other people outside Russia. The personal side of it, of me going back to Russia, is very closely linked with the side of wanting to do it to establish the Dharma there. It's certainly a help for us that Buddhism has been established for so long. The Gelug school of Tibetan Buddhism, monks from that tradition started teaching 400 years ago in Siberia. So now there's three Buddhist republics. When people meditate together, there's quite a strong communication. So I feel that the meditation practices that I've done for 20, 22 years, I share the fruits of those with people who are meditating with me maybe for the first time. There was a big step about 4 or 5 months ago when the person who became our first mitra, Zhena, she asked for ordination. So that was a big step in taking things, growing things a bit more than just having me as a Buddhist teacher.
Having a lovely, positive time with each other. Kind of looks wholesome, joyful, pleasure. A lot of people just enjoying themselves. If you chuck yourself wholeheartedly into something, sooner or later you find out who you are, because you get everything about you reflected back. Come together and commit themselves to doing something together. Yeah, I I've said it before, to the extent of which, like, there's practically no way out. The only way out is to come to terms with who you are and then say, oh, I'm responsible for that. I better start doing something about that. And to try and to fail, and then to try harder and fail harder, you know? That is, I really value that about this situation, and it's still working for me.
So working together is such a positive, strong experience for lots of people. The harmony that's created when people work together in a safe and loving space. Under pressure, but sort of somehow positive pressure, you know, with precepts in mind. So it's always held within a very positive space. And that has fed me, has made me realize what I have to offer. All my growing up, if you like, all my real unfolding, becoming who I am, has been through doing this. I think the festival has been an annual sort of marking of that each year, in a way, of growing in confidence and more and more faith. More and more faith in the Dharma, more and more ability to experience the joy.
I love how experimental it is. People seem very friendly, very colourful, always willing to help out. People feel quite overwhelmed by it, actually, sometimes. Yeah. It's like people are living up to their ideals here, which is really beautiful to see. Such amazing people all coming together and sharing, creating a space together, which I find magical. It's magical, that's what it would be.
Initially, it was people who had a very strong ethical passion, involved in social action, meeting Buddhism, and that was very much Lokabandhu's plan. And then the festival has just taken off since then, grown and grown and grown, from sort of 200 to 3,000 people.
It's been just an exploration of people coming in, kind of finding a place, finding there's plenty of opportunity for them to offer and give and create, and then they're accepted, really, and then they've kind of make it their own home. I think an awful lot of people find Buddhafield a very accepting place of them, of who they are. Now, of course, you know, I've got in mind, Bhante says, well, don't accept yourself, which I agree with too, but there's something about a need for people first to accept themselves, whatever they are, whoever they are, and then with love to start challenging themselves. For me, I think, and I'm confident it's the case for a lot of other people, you know, you start with your social sort of relations with other people. I think Buddhafield has just said, we love you and there's a place for you here. But I just think a lot of people need that. I certainly needed that. Obviously, though, the spiritual life goes a lot further beyond that. People come along to a festival and they kind of think it's just like any other festival, you know, whatever they've done at other festivals, whatever rules have been in their notion of a community, those are kind of what people assume it is. And there's a thing where it's the other edge of it, isn't it? In terms of being very accepting, Buddhafield hasn't been very authoritarian, it hasn't done an awful lot of boundary holding around saying, well, but this is what spiritual practice is and consists of. No, I don't want people to take that too literally, because I think there's been lots of effort to communicate within Buddhafield. But it just needs more and more of that. The Dharma has got something to say about kind of which way is up, and you know, what are positive states of mind, and what are negative ones, and what conduces to a more contented, loving state of mind, and what doesn't.
And then maybe they see sometimes it's not perfect, and they get disappointed. But
Buddha Field Festival has been such a wonderful experience for us. It's very lively, full of life, people are friendly.
Although there are so many tents and so many people here, but I still felt really calm and peaceful here. That's really wonderful.
Yes.
I find this place a place to express yourself, be yourself. People express themselves in many different ways. You can go with your clothes on or you can go without it.
It is like the feeling you get at the end of a retreat when everybody looks beautiful, you trust everybody's open heart, and it's like that, but with singing and dancing and joyfulness all thrown in. I've just had a wonderful dancing session at the end of that ritual with my chapter, and we were just all looking at each other and saying, wow, what a great chapter, and enjoying that sense of being order members together, feeling really full of love and being able to express it in a joyful sort of way.
It's always the right time to start working on friendship and relationship, and just one needs to do that in the good times, probably especially the good times, and in the bad times, you know, because sooner or later one's going to need that. Some being in the future will need the friendship that you can develop right now and the connection you can develop right now. You might need it, other beings might need it.
My name is Sanganath. I'm originally came from India, but I've been living here last 8 years. Currently I'm working with Karuna Trust. Karuna works in India among the disadvantaged communities, building dignity, self-respect, challenging caste system, eradicating poverty and so on. So I'm leading the Karuna appeals. So I'm training people how to fundraise, how to knock doors, and how to make connection with people.
That's something.
Well, something.
So what we do, we live together for 6 weeks. We practice together meditation. We study the Dhamma. We practice the spiritual friendship. And we train ourselves in communication, how to be authentic, how to be real, and go out in the evenings, knock doors on strangers and ask them if they want to support our work in India.
That's our first golden night.
Living as a spiritual practice here, coming together for 6 weeks, that has really, really good fruits, that has really good impacts on our increasing confidence level, if you like. We have an opportunity to practice Metta Bhavana because we are here for same purpose, for spiritual practice, but not necessarily we know each other very well beforehand. So we come up with just having one purpose, same purpose, but different characters, different personalities. So we have to cope with this. So we have to really, really kind of challenge ourselves to get out myself and just listen people and build friendship, really. The practice we do on the cushion, cultivating positive emotions about myself, about my friends, strangers, you know, and so on. In a way, Karuna Appeal, it's an opportunity to express that attitude to the outside world, if you like. It's a chance to how you emphasize on the doors with people. If people are rude, if people are trying to get rid of you on the doors, how are you going to deal with that? Yeah. And also at the same time, how are you going to have that attitude about yourself? So what's Metta Bhavana does is how you see yourself on the doors. I might be in frightened mental state, I might be in a negative mental state, but still there is a possibility I can communicate with people with kindness and friendliness.
I haven't been to India. I really want to go though.
Yes, yeah.
But I have supported Karuna.
You have to delicately kind of balance and hold kind of your connection with the charity and the cause in a way, your connection with yourself, your connection with the person on the door, and your kind of like sincere belief in giving in a way, as a positive kind of practice for the person on the door as well. And you have to kind of hold all of those together. And what you get when it actually works is just a complete open heart to the person on the door.
The real meta in this is that most people around the door are either third or fourth stage kind of people. So it's either very neutral and you don't have much to hold on to, or it's actually a bit negative. So you really, really have to turn inwards and find well-wishing towards these people too.
We're really, really going to try hard. We do some role plays around knocking doors. So we just, somebody will be a householder and somebody will be knocking door. And we just, I teach people how to communicate with that. So that's one thing. But it's often case of, I think it's building confidence on yourself, building confidence on the project we work in India, but also it's building confidence on trust on strangers. You know, sometimes you just knock doors and we come up with all sorts of stories. What people will say, people will reject me and so on. It's often a case of just letting go of the stories. I benefited from Karuna's project when I was a kid in India. When I was 8-9 years old, I come across a project called Ashwagosh. Ashwagosh is a project mainly focused on kids, children in India, and it's funded by Karuna Trust. I have seen myself changing, and I have seen people are changing in India because of the Karuna's work. So when I came here, I had opportunity to do Karuna Appeals, yeah. And I think it's my responsibility to continue these conditions for others. We are raising money for someone who needs it in India. So people really desperately looking for help to come out from poverty, come out from caste system, wanting to dignity and self-respect and so on. So we are raising money for those kind of people. That's kind of real kindness. It's not just about me and about you, it's about something else.
People that India Dharma Trust is trying to help are the so-called untouchables, or better, the Dalits, or even better, the new Buddhists. So these are the people right at the bottom of the Indian caste system. economically, but also in terms of their very status in society, are really oppressed. And for them, Buddhism has been just a whole new identity and path for transformation out of that oppression. So we're really glad to support the Indian ordination teams. It's very significant the impact that the order members can have in India. There's a really big impact just through how they're living their lives. Of course, all order members take the 10 precepts, and that's really significant. But also, of course, they're able to teach meditation and to pass on the teachings of Buddhism, the wisdom of the Buddha, which changes people's lives for the better. And of course, people see that, and they want that. And they particularly want that because Dr. Ambedkar advised them that that was what they needed. And there's an incredible faith in the Dalit or new Buddhist community towards Dr. Ambedkar. There's now a public preceptor, an Indian Dharmacharya is a public preceptor, Jnanashuri, who was actually present at Dr. Ambedkar's conversion in 1956. He was a young child.
खूप मोठ्या प्रमाणात लोक तिथे आलेले होते सकाळी 14 तारखेला सकाळी साधारणतः 6:30 आम्ही मोर्चाने तिकडे जायला सगळे लोक वस्तीतले लोक मिळून आम्ही जायला निघालो आणि मग म्हणजे आपल्या इथल्या भारतीय पद्धतीप्रमाणे एका बाजूला महिला बसल्या होत्या एका बाजूने पुरुष बसले होते आणि मी तसं म्हटलं तर खूप लकी आहे की मी समोर बसले होते आणि खूप आनंदाने तिथपर्यंत लोक जात होते आणि जेव्हा आम्ही तिथे पोहोचलो तर तो 14 एकराचा जो दीक्षाभूमीचा परिसर होता तो पूर्ण भरून गेलेला होता कारण काही लोक तिथेच मुक्कामाला होते म्हणजे मला तेव्हा एवढं जाणवत होतं की आता आम्ही हिंदू धर्म सोडणार आहोत आणि खूप काहीतरी चांगलं बुद्ध धर्मामध्ये आम्हाला मिळणार आहे एवढंच त्यावेळी मला समजत होतं
Dalit women in India face a sort of double discrimination, if you like, being both Dalit, of course, and because of their gender. So there's very little freedom to, for example, get an education or one's own livelihood. What's been really delightful to see increasingly over the years are the number of new Buddhist women who are getting a kind of personal, economic and social independence in their lives. And some are even choosing not to get married and have a family and actually be full-time Dharma workers. And that's a real boon for the women Sangha, because of course then there are women who are able to travel around, teach the Dharma, work in retreat centers and so forth.
I work for Aryatara Mahila Trust, which is based in Pune. And the project I'm working, that name is Majhi Asmita, and the English meaning of that is my dignity. Because in India, the women's situation is very different than any other places. These women in Rajasthan and Gujarat, they are much behind than us. I would say they are 40 years behind than us, what situation they are having there. They don't have any education, totally fully illiterate women are there. They don't have any of the good facility in their life. They don't have any toilets, any bathrooms in their houses. And we stay 3 days in one village. One day we are teaching them the Buddhism and the meditation, the Metta Bhavana. And the 2 other days, we go house to house and do a lot of home visits. So we are talking with the whole family. And at the same time, we are working with the schools also. There are children who has admitted in the school, but they never turn to the school. So we try to go to their houses and try to motivate those children and their parents also to send them to the school.
The thing I think that is such an unusual thing is the idea of women working together for women. So one of the things that the ordination team do a great deal of is developing Kalyana Mitrata, because that's an unusual thing. You have families for that in India. You don't have other people to whom you are not biologically related or related by marriage. And so the idea of building Kalyana Mitrata is quite challenging, I think, in some ways. But it's one of the things that changes women's view, the idea that you work together with other women on a project that's not for your family.
Because my grandfather, my parents were follow the Dr. Ambedkar, what he suggested to do first is education. So they were so poor. My grandfather was very poor. They were, you know, having first education and then later on food. So there is food is secondary things, but education is very important. So they got this all struggle. But we, as a maybe third generation, as my third generation was get good benefits of that. But I don't want it to be stay in that benefits and indulge, you know, in that benefit. I wanted to do something kind of work. So many thousand people are, you know, still suffering, still need some kind of guidance, kind of they are in confused state, they don't know what to do in their life. And when I saw this suffering, I thought I like to do this work and I like to give a little bit from my life. Yeah.
Now I am doing not different from my professional things. Not as a doctor, but as a helping, as a social helper. Like I want to help those people who are like my past. Oh, sorry. So I'm doing for those girls who are bright like me and who can do their future brighter like me, and then they can help me, like I am helping to the other poor people.